Good morning, brothers and sisters. Welcome to the Edgewater Baptist online service for Sunday, April 5, 2020. Because of the restrictions placed on public gatherings, we will be using this medium to still have our morning worship service. Welcome to everyone tuned in, and a very special welcome to our first-time visitors. Special welcome also to our brothers and sisters from the Waterford Baptist Church. Our leader today is Deacon Michael Blake, and our preacher is our very own pastor, Reverend Dr. Dylan Toussaint. We pray God continued blessings upon them and their families. In today's service, Holy Communion will be observed. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Our worship team will now lead us in a time of praise and worship. Please sing along with us.
Ancient, ancient, ancient of days. Ancient, ancient, ancient of days. Ancient, ancient, ancient of days. Ancient, ancient, ancient of days.
Blessing and honor,
blessing and honor, glory and power be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days.
Blessing and honor,
glory and power be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Ancient, ancient, ancient of days. Ancient, ancient, ancient of days.
Your kingdom shall reign over all the earth.
Sing to the Ancient of Days. For none can compare to your matchless worth. Sing to the Ancient of Days.
Every tongue
in heaven shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you'll be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away.
Oh, Ancient of Days, ancient, ancient, ancient of days.
Ancient,
ancient, ancient of days. Ancient, ancient, ancient of days.
Ancient,
ancient, ancient of
days. These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on a cloud, shining like the sun, and the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
There's no God like Jehovah, 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 there's no God like Jehovah. 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 There's no God like Jehovah.
There's no God like Jehovah. Behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, and the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's here to lead, and out of Zion's hill salvation come. Lift your voice, it's here to lead, and out of Zion's hill salvation
you. Sisters and brothers in Christ, we give God thanks for the opportunity to worship together again this Palm Sunday morning. We thank you for joining us throughout the world in your living rooms and wherever you are. Let us go to God in prayer. Almighty God, everlasting Father, Father, Redeemer, Comforter, you are holy, O God, and you are from everlasting to everlasting. We give you thanks, Lord God, on this another Palm Sunday, as we remember, O God, your triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Heavenly Father, we worship you because you are from everlasting to everlasting. Lord, we thank you for your presence in our lives. We thank you, God, for the protection that you afford us. We thank you, O God, for your peace that passeth all understanding. Lord, as we worship this morning, we confess, O God, that we have sinned and come short of your glory. And so, God, we pray for your forgiveness. Forgive us, Lord. Jehovah Rapha, God who heals, we present ourselves to you this morning, O God, for your healing. By your stripes, Lord Jesus, we are healed. And Lord, we want to ask you, particularly in this situation with the COVID-19 disease, O God, the COVID-19 virus, we pray for your protection. We pray for your healing, O God. Lord, the healthcare workers, the doctors, the nurses, and all the other healthcare professionals, we put them before you at this time, Lord. Grant your divine protection upon them, O God. And as they fight this disease at the front lines, we pray for your protection. Lord, we want to also pray for your protection and for your guidance for those who are the ones who are involved in the preparation, in the presentation, and in the distribution of food, O God. Because without food, O Lord, all of us will perish. Heavenly Father, we pray for those who are in the transport sector. We pray for those, we pray for the security forces, O God. We pray, Lord God, for your guiding hand upon those who are in leadership. We pray for leadership from the political dispensation and from the community, O God. Lord, we pray for your protection on the leaders of the church. And we ask, O God, that you will continue to protect us. Lord God, we pray, mighty God, and present to you those who have been infected by COVID-19. Grant your healing upon them, O God. Heavenly Father, we pray for comfort for those who have suffered the loss of loved ones. Comfort us, O God. Lord God, Spirit of the living God, we pray, mighty God, for your anointing upon us this morning. We pray especially, O God, for your anointing upon Reverend Toussaint, your servant who will deliver your word this morning. Heavenly Father, we are confident, O God, that you will take care of us. Because indeed, Lord, we are in your hands. The entire world, O God, are in your hands. And so, Lord, we place today, tomorrow, and forever in your hands. These mercies we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning, our psalm comes to us from Psalm 24, and we will ask Deacon Adolf Roden to read for us.
The scripture reading comes to us this morning from Psalm 24. We begin. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. For he hath founded it upon the seas and established it upon the floods. Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in his holy place? He that hath clean hands and a pure heart, who hath not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. He shall receive the blessing from the Lord, and righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is the generation of them that seek him, that seek thy face, O Jacob. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, even lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We will now listen to the announcements.
Announcements. All weekly activities at the church will be suspended until further notice. Please be in touch with your respective class leaders for information and any updates. Remember the sick and shut-ins. Please visit or call if you can and keep them in your prayers. Happy anniversary to anyone celebrating wedding anniversary this week. God continued blessings on your marriage. Also, happy birthday to anyone celebrating birthday this week. Many happy returns and God's blessings be yours as well.
He's a man of mystery, an interpreter of dreams. He was thrown in the lion's den.
Call upon your name, O Lord.
The three Hebrew boys.
Lord, save me!
Why do they not bear?
The finger writing on the wall. A book written between the 6th and the 7th century BC. It's the apocalyptic book of the Old Testament. Join the Reverend Dr. Dylan Toussaint Wednesday nights at 7:30 for The Daniel Story. A book written by Daniel himself. The Daniel Story, Wednesday nights at 7:30.
Sisters and brothers in Christ, this morning, the word of God will be delivered to us by our own pastor, the Reverend Dr. Dylan Toussaint. However, before he comes to us, Sister Claudine Lewis from the Waterford Baptist Church will minister to us in song. Sister Lewis.
Now Jesus was going up on his way to Jerusalem, to be lifted high on a tree, that he might call men unto him. Now the multitude began to praise him, while others were trying to stop him. He said, if they hold their peace, the rocks are gonna cry out. And there is one last stone, one more voice to praise the mighty name, the name of the Lord. And I'm one last stone, one more voice to praise him. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Now David was a man of praise, praising God in the sanctuary. He praised him on the trumpets and the harp, and he praised him in the dance. I don't want to offend anybody, but I'm gonna praise my Jesus. He said, if I own my peace, the rocks are gonna cry out. And there is one less stone, one more voice to praise a mighty name, the name of the Lord. And I'm one less stone, one more voice to praise him. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Now David was a man of praise, praising God in a sanctuary. He praised him on the top of them harp, and he praised him in the dance. I don't want to offend anybody, but I'm gonna worship Jesus. He said, if I own my peace, the rocks are gonna cry out. And there is one less stone, and I'm one more voice to praise a mighty name, the name of the Lord. And I'm one less stone, one more voice to praise him. Blessed is the King, comes in the name of the Lord. David was a man of praise, praising God in the sanctuary. He praised him on the trumpet and the harp, and he praised him in the dance. We don't want to offend anybody, but we gonna worship Jesus. He said, if we all are peace, the rocks are gonna cry out. And there is one less stone, one more voice. Praise the mighty name, the name of the Lord. One less stone, one more voice to praise him. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. David was a man of praise, praising God in a sanctuary. He praised him on the trumpet and the harp, and he praised him in the dance. I don't want to offend anybody, but I'm gonna worship Jesus. He said, if I own my peace, the rocks are gonna cry out. And there is one less stone, one more voice. Praise the mighty name, the name of the Lord. One less stone, one more voice to praise him. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, friends all, good morning. Wherever you are, my hope is that this service has been and will continue to be a time of meditation and a source of inspiration. Believe it or not, this is another Palm Sunday, a day which is reserved on the Christian calendar for the commemoration of the triumphal entry of Christ into Jerusalem. And this took place before he was crucified on Calvary's cross. So, Palm Sunday serves as a preparation for that event. Now, for some people, Palm Sunday is really not such a big deal. For some people, Palm Sunday is like any other Sunday. But not so with the gospel writers. Because indeed, all four of them, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, recorded the events that were included in the Lord's triumphal entry. albeit they did it from different angles. And isn't it true that it is possible for persons to be looking at the same thing, even at the same time, in the same place and space, but still report different things? Why? Because people can be looking at it from different perspectives or different experiences, different interests, and different issues behind it. But the beautiful thing is that when we look on the Easter story, when we look on the Palm Sunday account, all of the four Gospels, in the end, point to Jesus Christ. And they point to his entering into Jerusalem to fulfill God's mandate on his life. It is against that background that we come this morning to look at Luke's account of the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. And we look at it from Luke chapter 19, verse 37 to verse 40. I'm reading from the King James Version. "And when he," Jesus, "was come nigh, even now at the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen, saying, Blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And some of the Pharisees among the multitude said unto him, Master, rebuke thy disciples. And he answered and said unto them, I tell you, that if these should hold their peace, the stones would immediately cry out. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." Now, in this section of Luke's account, we get at least three main things being evident. Three main things that Luke obviously wanted to highlight about this Palm Sunday event. And the first thing I'd like to share with us, because Luke actually seemingly wants us to focus on it, is what I would like to call a multitude of rejoicing. A multitude of rejoicing. It says in verse 37 and verse 38, the whole multitude of the disciples or followers began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, Blessed be the King that comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Those of you who are keen observers would perhaps realize that this is one of those times, in fact, the only other time that we find a similar set of sentiments being expressed to Jesus was when he was born. Because in Luke's account, we find the angels declaring glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill toward men. So Jesus got this at the time of his birth, and he also got this moments before his death. Now, the last time I checked, the word multitude may be interpreted to mean a massive crowd. A massive crowd. Some Jamaicans would say a whole heap of people or a crowd of people. It speaks, beloved, that of the fact that a number of persons were there, more than usual, assembled as they sought to glorify God in Christ. The word multitude may also be interpreted not only in terms of a massive crowd, but a mixed crowd. That perhaps as Jesus was now on that donkey, ascending, going through and to Jerusalem, we find that there is a mixed crowd as well in this massive crowd. And perhaps in that mixed crowd, there were young and old, rich or poor, educated or uneducated persons, persons from uptown, persons from downtown. But they were all there glorifying God in Christ. What a beautiful sight this must have been. To see all of them in one accord, no doubt, lifting up the name of Jesus, lifting up the Lord, and praising God in the highest. I believe, beloved, that that is symbolic of what true worship ought to be. True worship is not about where we come from. It's not about who we are. It's not about how educated or uneducated we may feel, because the ground is level at the foot of the cross. That is the reality. But I think it also ought to reflect what church ought to be about. That no matter who we are, no matter where we are from, when it comes down to the worship of Almighty God, He is the one who is exalted, and Him alone. It's not about who is beside us. It's not about who is in front or behind us. It's about Jesus Christ. That is the essence of true worship. But you know, when you read this passage, and no matter how often I have looked on this text, every time you look, you see something different. Because really and truly, as good and great as it was that they were lifting up the name of the Lord, I sense in my spirit when I read that perhaps there were some things missing and that their rejoicing was a bit limited. Let me explain. First of all, they were praising God, says the scripture, for the mighty works that He had done. But I want to suggest to us that we not only should praise Him for His mighty works, but we ought to praise Him as well for those miniature works. Those things that sometimes seem minuscule, we are to praise Him for those things as well. Not only for those things that are grand, not only those things that are big and wonderful, but for the small mercies that we see. We praise Him for the fact that He woke us up this morning. We praise Him for the fact that we will have food on our table. We praise Him this morning that we have clothes on our backs. We praise Him that we are in our right mind. The miniature things as well as the mighty things. The Bible says that they also praised Him that day for what they had seen. But I put it to us that we also need to praise God for the things that are not seen. The things that are not seen. The things that Almighty God does for us that we don't even know. And as I speak about that, I remember many years ago hearing the testimony of someone who said that when he went to get his heart checked thoroughly, it was a special machine to the point that it could detect that the year or years before he had had some minor heart attacks, but he didn't know. And I want to say, church, that sometimes we need to pause and say, God, I thank You, not only for what I see and what I know, but even what I don't see and what I don't know. Because God, sometimes some things could have come our way, but if it were not for the grace and mercy of God, we would have been destroyed. We praise Him not only for what is seen, but what is also unseen. The Bible says that they also praised Him praised him because of what he had done. But could I also suggest we need to praise him, not only for what he had done, but praise him for what he is doing and what he shall do. In other words, we give him thanks in advance. We say, God, even though I don't know what is ahead, I know that you are still in control, and I praise you for that. So, Palm Sunday is in essence about worship. It's about praising God. It's about lifting up the name of Jesus, not only for the mighty things, but the seemingly miniature things. Not only for the things that we see, but the things that we don't see. Not only for what he has done, but for what he is doing and what he shall do. So that's the first observation that I think Luke wants us to highlight: a multitude rejoicing. But secondly, when you read this text, not only do we see a multitude rejoicing, but watch this, everybody, we also see a misguided request. A misguided request. Because in verse 39, it says that some of the Pharisees from among the multitude said unto him, Master, rebuke thy disciples. Master, rebuke thy disciples. Now, note quickly, everybody, who they were. And who were they? They were Pharisees, the self-acclaimed teachers and keepers of the law. Who were they? Pharisees, who felt that nobody knew the law like they did. Who were they? Pharisees who believed that they were holier than everybody else. Note as well from whence they came. The Bible said they came from among the multitude. In other words, from among the same crowd, the same massive crowd that was praising God in the highest. From among them, the Pharisees came. Beware of those among the multitude who possess a Pharisaic spirit without even us knowing it. Never get caught up in the crowd. Never believe that everybody who says yay and everybody who acclaims you and everybody who praises you is for you. Because even within that crowd, there are the naysayers. Even within that crowd, there are those who may be cutting you down left, right, and center. Even within that crowd, there might be those who are misguided in their philosophy. Among the crowd, among the multitude, were the Pharisees who came to Jesus and they made a request, Master, rebuke thy disciples. I want to ask a question that I believe is a question that needs to be asked and an answer sought. Why did they make this request of Jesus? Why did they ask Jesus, rebuke your disciples? Note, everybody, they come to Jesus and they address him quite appropriately. They call him Master. But now they are saying, rebuke your disciples. Why would they make such a request? I'll leave with us two possible reasons. One, they thought the disciples were too radical. They thought the disciples were too radical. Please remember that along with all that was said about God in Christ, they went on to say, blessed be the King. Blessed be the King that comes in the name of the Lord, in reference to Jesus. And the Pharisees would have none of that. None of that. How dare you now regard Jesus as our King? Careful, they were saying. Careful, lest the King of the land gets upset with that type of rhetoric. And so They were saying, this is too radical a message. This is too radical, radical a philosophy. Jesus, tell your disciples to keep quiet. You know where I'm going with this? That I want to say, beloved, that when you are really sold out for Jesus, sometimes your message becomes radical that some people cannot absorb it. Sometimes when you're really sold out for Jesus, the persons who find it difficult for us to understand or difficult for us to claim and to state that Jesus Christ is Lord and that he rules our lives. When you are sold out for Jesus, not everybody will see eye to eye with you. But the disciples were radical in the crowd. And they were declaring, blessed be the King who comes in the name of the Lord. But I also ask, why? Why would they make that request of Jesus? Why would they say, Jesus, tell your disciples to calm down and to be quiet? First of all, they perhaps thought the disciples were too radical. But secondly, they perhaps thought the disciples were too vocal. The disciples were too vocal. Please remember, everybody, it says that they made a loud voice, or with a loud voice, they declared him. A loud voice. And I don't want to overdo this point, but I would like to say, beloved, that when you really know God, and when you really want to praise him, you become like the psalmist who says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. The psalmist also says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. When it comes on to praising God, we don't hide and do this. When it comes on to praise God, we are vocal, and we can even be interpreted as being radical because we know who the Lord is and what he has meant to us. And so this is what was happening. The Pharisees came to Jesus with this misguided request. Jesus, rebuke your disciples. Please, Master, rebuke them. They are too radical and they are too vocal. Let me move on, therefore, to say that after we come into this text and we see a multitude rejoicing, and we now hear a misguided request, final observation is what I want to call a masterful response. A masterful response. You see, a while ago, the Pharisees referred to Jesus as master. And Jesus gave them a masterful response in verse 40. He answered and said unto them, I tell you that if these should hold their peace, the stones, would immediately cry out. A masterful response. You see, by that response, I believe Jesus revealed two things. Two things that I must share with you before I close this sermon. One, it reveals the Lord's worthiness. The Lord's worthiness. Jesus says, remember, I tell you, if these should hold their peace, the stones would immediately cry out. Why? Because the Lord is forever worthy to be praised. Worthy to be praised. He is God Almighty. He is the Lord. He is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is in control of everything. He is our creator. He is our redeemer. And he is forever worthy to be praised. If I should hold, if they should hold their peace, Jesus is saying, the stones will cry out because the Lord is always worthy to be praised. It shows the Lord's worthiness. But finally, it shows the Lord's awesomeness. The Lord's awesomeness. And I want to say this, church, the Lord is not dependent on us to praise him. Let me say that again. God in Christ, the Lord, is not dependent on us to praise him. Why? Because if we choose not to, if all of humanity chooses not to, Jesus, by that statement, is saying that the rocks, hallelujah, would cry out. They would praise him even if we don't. He is that awesome. He's that awesome. Creation praises him. And therefore, even if humanity ceases to do that, and I doubt it will happen, but even if it were to happen, we would see the rock starting to praise God and lift up his name and say glory to God in the highest, because God is that awesome. Beloved, as we commemorate another Palm Sunday, wherever you are, whoever you are, Palm Sunday is essentially about worship. It's about worship. And that is why, in spite of all that is happening around the world, in spite of the fact that many churches today are not worshiping where they used to worship, in a building, wherever we are still worshiping him, because he is still worthy to be praised. That is what Palm Sunday reminds us of in the midst of this COVID crisis. It reminds us that Christ is still Lord and still in control, and he's worthy to be praised. So, Palm Sunday story, a multitude rejoicing, a misguided request, a masterful response. May I ask us all then to, in everything we do and say, give the highest praise to God. In every circumstance, every situation, give him due praise. He's worthy and he's awesome. And even if we don't, even if all of humanity ceased, the rocks would do it because he's that awesome. Amen. And so, let us pray. Lord, on this another Palm Sunday, wherever we are, whoever we are, we give you praise. We give you praise. And as those persons on that day, over 2,000 years ago, decided that no matter who was looking, and no matter what they were saying, they were going to still exalt your name, we do so now with all our hearts. In so doing, God, we acknowledge that there are those who are going through some trying times, that those who are facing some challenging tests. We pray for each of them. But at the same time, we praise you because you are still in control. So, Lord, as we prepare throughout the rest of this week for Good Friday and for Resurrection Easter Sunday, may our time, may our days be well spent in your presence as we, above everything else, give you all the honor, all the glory that is due to your holy name. We pray this now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. Praise him, praise him, praise him, praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. He's worthy, he's worthy to be praised. Praise him, praise him, praise him, praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised.
Beloved, as we come to this sacred table, not because we must, but because we may. We come as an act of fellowship, and we come as an act of obedience to the Lord. And so as we come, we hear the words of the Lord saying to us, "Come unto me, all ye who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in spirit, and you shall find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." And so as we come, I invite us all to bow our heads and our hearts as we go to God in prayer, as we self-examine and ask for God's mercy.
Let us pray. Lord, we your people do come. We thank you for this new day, this Palm Sunday, a day, O God, that we can still experience your mercy and your grace. As we come to this table, Lord, we may be far apart, but we thank you, God, that through your redemptive power and the use of social media, you can bring us together to this table. Oh God, we pray even now for these emblems, that as we put them to use for your glory, that you will bless the wine, which represents your outpoured blood shed for us. The bread, O God, your broken body, broken for us. Lord, in this difficult and unprecedented time, may your glory continue to be with us. May your peace, O God, continue to reign through us. And as we eat and drink together as a family, Lord, we pray that these emblems and your power, God, will bring healing to our bodies and to our land. Father God, we thank you because of who you are. We thank you, O God, because of your great might and your great power, and that you will come through for us.
And we say thanks through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much, Deacon Roden. The Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had broken it, he said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." And after the same manner also, he took the cup and said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Whenever you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me. For as often as we eat the bread and drink from the cup, we do show the Lord's death until he comes." Deacons. Body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which was broken for us, eat and be thankful. Of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which was shed for us, drink and be thankful. So, Lord, we are grateful to you for another opportunity you have given unto us to celebrate, to commemorate your death, your burial, and your resurrection. We once again thank you that when you were on that cross, we were on your mind. And so now, as we have partaken once again, we thank you for the added meaning out of this symbolism. We thank you, Lord, that you have called us as well to take up our cross individually and to follow you. So we reaffirm our faith. We rededicate our lives to you as we give you all the honor and the glory. Amen. God bless you.
Thank you for joining us. We hope you will join us again as we worship together. Please remember to pray for each other and maintain the required social distance. There is power in prayer. Have a blessed week.